Oh, I like the strawberry, but I don't have busy. I have strawberry now. Hi there, $5.
What we'll do, we'll put a couple coffee cups over here in case somebody wants to, you know, just to...
Okay, so I can give it to them?
Yeah.
Okay. And then, thank you so much. Enjoy. $10, please.
You got coffee, too?
Yeah. You want a cup?
We've just been informed that we have a wonderful door prize this year. We have a Toyota automobile. Whosever car this key fits, it's yours. No, that's not right. Let's see. It's a Toyota key fob, and it has a Mickey Mouse. And I can't read it without my... What's his name? Grandma? Well, that narrows it down considerably. All right, so we've got a pair of keys, set of keys here. They'll figure it out soon. They'll be spending the night in Nassau. Nice place for the match. But be careful, there's barriers across the way. So, you've been listening to us, you've been very, very polite, a little bit restrained, and you realize you're here in a house of worship. But we can worship music, right? We can sing along the music. We have two members of the choir right here who sing every week. I heard them over there. So we're going to sing. But I know you don't all know the words. And I always say I don't have to know the words because I play in the band. So there's two words, three words. God. I'm saying God. God. If you're Russian, you say God is yes. God. And then Ma. Like mother, ma, and da, and then n, and then n. You get that kind of nasal n. I don't know, the Germans have a umlaut, I don't know what that is. What's that? Oh, stop it. You know, sometimes they don't get it. The song is called Mana, Mana. Any of you recognize it by the name Mana, Mana? Have any of you, well, that's how it's written. Ma, na, ma, na. Well, the accent right from the A. Do any of you, if you're youth, remember the, what were they?
Muppets.
The Muppets. The Muppets, right. The Muppets, okay. Okay. You remember the Muppets. Ma, na, ma, na. Ba, 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 ba. Ma, na, ma, na. Ba, ba, ba.
Thank you.
perfect earlier today. We're going to play that all afternoon long. She was like, come on. That's what you call pure warm. It's in your ear. So one of the big benefits of our musical organization coming here, as you folks hopefully have already partaken, is to have a chance to have some fresh strawberry shortcake with all that whipped cream and delicious, delicious shortcakes. Did you have some, any of you?
Yes.
How was it? Alright. We are going to dismiss this board. They're all going to go downstairs, but they're going to be back at 10 minutes to 8, okay? 20 minutes. Don't spill on your shirts. We've got 6 more weeks of concerts. You need to keep your shirts clean. So we're going to take about 20 minutes, but while you feel free to stay here, you can ask the musicians for autographs. They don't mind, but just don't get in front of the line of the strawberries. So we'll be back in a few minutes. Thank you so much for being here.
Fictional, real cowboy, a gunslinger, and he was a big
program that had grown at the time, and he achieved that nickname, Wider for Doc Avery. And if you had a tendency to be slightly to the left of the rules, you didn't like that. A lot of people didn't like him. Some of the best stories, however, if you ever saw movies about growing up in the 50s and 60s when a bunch of wise guys would take a chain or a rope and tie a black bumper or a police car to a movable object and then the police would accelerate very quickly, that happened here in Nassau. You can still do newspaper searches. Santa Claus arrested on Christmas Eve. He was a very big enforcer of the speed limit. At that time, it was 25 on all the streets. And if you went 26, 27, you probably got pulled over. And if he was suspect, you probably got a ticket. The justice of the peace, the first year he was police chief, quit because there were so many tickets he had to process. So those are some of our stories that we hold true. True and dear, only in a little village. If you've never lived in a little village, it's different. You know, you go in the post office, they got your mail before you go to get it yourself. Everybody knows your name. It's like Cheers, right? We've got some natives here. So speaking of little villages, Nassau has always had a very big tradition in baseball. It used to be adults, and then it got to be teenage players, and now it's just little league, very young. And we have a nice ball field on the former fairgrounds. This was once the site of the Rensselaer County Fair. And the ball field is named after Judge Lamb, James Lamb, who lived down the street, who was the Justice of Peace for many, many years. And he's the guy that got to replace the previous justice who quit because he couldn't deal with the tickets. So he had no problem with hitting the gavel and sending him to Troy or somewhere. Probably not seeing the same, but somewhere. And he was very, very well respected in Nassau. He was a great supporter of the baseball league. Of course, it's the NBA, Nassau Baseball League here. We also have the NFL, the Nassau Free Riders. A lot of names that have been stolen by other people. But one of the great ironies of Judge Lamb is he had a large family, but he had no sons. So he never had any kids at that time. Girls didn't play baseball. I was just speaking to his granddaughter a few weeks ago. She came to visit the cemetery and et cetera, et cetera. She was very surprised. I do remember. So I can't remember their names, but I remember the people that grew up with them. So we are going to talk about baseball. That's right. There goes my intro. How many of you are, let's see, New York Yankee fans? Any New York Yankee fans? Okay. How about any Met fans? Let's see, there's that team in Cincinnati. A lot of people like the Reds, the Pirates, there's always Pirate fans. What?
Thank you.
as to exactly how modern we should take the music. You know, we seem to do pretty, we have a little niche from about 1902 to about 1937. We're pretty safe in playing that music. There's not much syncopation. There's not much crazy things going on. Once we get newer than that, however, all bets are off. However, I know that we have a lot of youth with us tonight. So now, people like you, John, we're going to do our youth segment. And hopefully, you know some of these songs. Now, I do feel a little bit queasy about this next tune and performing in a church. But I just want you to think of the larger message, not the specific message that you may remember from the honky-tonk singer that became very famous singing this song. So think of the greater good and love thy neighbor. The song, I Can't Stop Loving You. And watch out for the trombone player. August 11th, 8/11, we'll be playing at the gazebo We rebuilt the gazebo, remember I told you about the one on the corner of Church Street. It's now in our little park next to the post office on John Street, so the group will be there. A whole new program. No, it's the same program. If you know anyone who might be interested, bring your lawn chairs, bring your tick spray. Hopefully we'll have a nice night. So, all right, so maybe we didn't swing on that one too much, did we? We'll keep working on it, won't we? By the end of the season, it'll be great. So if you think that was blasphemous to do in the church, now we've got a song where it talks about drinking alcohol. Now this is just talking about it. Remember Jimmy Carter, I sinned in my heart, or something, I lusted, and he didn't really do it, he just thought about it. We'll sort of use those same parameters. Margaritaville. Yeah. Can you believe it? Margaritaville. Unfortunately, we do not have samples here. One would go pretty good right about now. But we hope you know the song. It's a nice summer song. It's an easy song. And we are going to, as they used to say, render it for you right now. Three new people. Did I forget anybody? I don't think so. It's embarrassing when you forget who the musicians are. But, so that's good. And hopefully we can continue on. If any of you have an interest in traditional woodwind percussion brass music, we meet Thursday nights throughout the year at the Village Ball here in Nassau. Basically, our summer, quote-unquote, season starts with this event, the Strawberry Festival, and then the succeeding Thursdays through the summer, we go around and perform mostly at senior centers. So we try to bring a little bit of good cheer to folks. Some of the music we play probably is not your cup of tea, but seems to go well in retirement homes. How about that? They speak our language. So, however, we do at times try to keep up right with the most modern things. There's this new group, I don't know if you've heard of them, the Beatles. They're very big. And we have a medley of some of their greatest tunes, and I bet you know them. So if you know the words, feel free to sing them.
Thank you.
car is it? What make is it? What's on the key fob? Well, we don't want any impersonators here. Well, she won't forget she lost her key in the Maxwell. Thank you for the Beatles. They did a nice job. What is it, the 50th year? This year? 50th? What is it? No, the Beatles. All right. I know it's an anniversary year, but obviously I missed it.
Don't leave. We only have one more. No. Please feel free to do what you have to do. So, Dr. Zhivago didn't make out so well, did he? No. The only non-Russian thing in there. Well, next time. Well, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the community band, on behalf of the Grace United Methodist Church, we thank you very, very much for being here tonight. It is a much anticipated function. This and the election night roast beef dinner are the two big public efforts that the Grace United Methodist Church undertakes. However, there's going to be news pretty soon about this church, so you keep paying attention. There's going to be news. So, we would like to close with a polka. I changed my mind. We haven't played a polka yet. This is a new polka, believe it or not. Most people think of polkas old, you know, Pennsylvania polka, beer barrel polka. Well, I'm sorry to disappoint you, ladies and gentlemen. Polkas weren't made in America. They were made somewhere else, farther away in Central Europe. And in particularly in a place that used to officially be called Bohemia. Officially, there is no more Bohemia, but there are provinces in the Czech Republic, the current Czech Republic, of South Bohemia and North Bohemia, believe it or not. And very, very beautiful rolling landscape, a lot of thermal springs. And you know what they're very famous for making there, among other things? Beer. Can you believe that? The Czechs have a very, very high beer culture. They drink more beer than the Germans, if that is possible, and it's very, very good beer. And they were the ones who developed a process called Pilsner beer, because one of the cities in this area is the city of Pilsen. So that gave its name to Pilsner beer. But we are going to play a polka that is maybe 15, 20 years old. It is still, brass bands in Europe play polkas, believe it or not. In this country, not so much. But we do. It's called the South Bohemian Polka. It's not as fast as you may think, but we hope you enjoy it. And it features all of our wonderful lower brass, as well as the rest of the musicians.
Nassau Free Library, Nassau, New York. Rensselaer County, State of New York.
Okay.
USA.
Great, if you're looking at like grad school down the line.
I don't know how many people.
Thank you so much.
Somewhere other than being the greatest veterinarian school in like the whole world. Or something like that. I think we have a great veterinarian school. But
thank you so much.
What did they call it? The school of what?
Cornell's College of Veterinary Medicine.
What is it, dear?
College of Veterinary Medicine. But the one I'll be going to, because it's undergraduate and I have to do that before going to the vet school, is College of Agriculture and Life Sciences.
Yeah.
You're gonna have like a so much fun at the college events. They have like bonfires together and they do a bunch of really fun like outings together. Outdoor Odyssey too. That's a good thing to get involved in.
I signed up for Post.
Oh, okay, Post is good. Post is good. My friends were Outdoor Odyssey fans. So.
A song circle or a story circle, or a joke circle, or anything, any type of spoken word or sung, just instrumental that you want to go along with. And as I said in my little poster, this is what some people used to do on Friday nights before we had TVs.
Yes!
There would be, you know, I am old enough, believe it or not, I am old enough to remember listening to the Lone Ranger on the radio and the Phantom. Yeah, because that was in the 50s. The 50s, they were still doing radio programs in the 50s. And for some reason, I have a really good memory of being able to listen. I listened to those. And some of those stories were just great stories, and so I'm a big fan of storytelling, and usually, you know, I usually start with a song, but I think I'm going to start with a story tonight instead, if everybody's okay with that.
Sure.
Okay.
Yes.
Let me tell you about Hotz Kowalewski.
Say his name again.
Hotz Kowalewski.
Oh, Hotz Kowalewski.
And I'm not even sure what his real name is, because that was the name that he did. And it started, how I met him was kind of interesting. I was really into music as a teenager. That was one of my driving forces. You know, I wasn't into sports. Well, I was, but I was terrible at it. But I was into music, and I was playing in the high school marching band and the stage band and the orchestra as a drummer. And so, but I was really into rock music, and one of the things that was kind of like a competition among us music nerds is to find the next new big thing, and to be the first one to know about it, and to, you know, and so, and to discover something. So there's always this competition going on, and I always prided myself as being the guy that knew about the next big thing first. And what was very disturbing for me is I was riding in my bicycle down Pine Street in Hudson Falls, where I grew up. And as I was driving down the street, I could hear music, and it was really good rock music, and I had no idea what it was, and so I was really upset because I needed to know what that was. So being the pretty, you know, like a kind of a bold kid, I basically knocked on the door and said, "Hi, my name's Pat. What's that music going?" And the woman that answered the door was the best way I can describe her as an Earth Mother from the 60s, if you can picture that, you know, the long flowing skirt, the hair, all.
All right. So I'll start with, you know, for today it's Flag Day.
Is it?
Yes.
It is.
So, you want me to
move? No, I don't.
Goosebumps.
Tracy, would you be so kind?
You can't laugh too hard, right? No,
it's running, honey.
All right.
All you have to do is aim it.
All I have to do is aim it.
Well, hi there, folks. How are you tonight?
Good.
How are you?
This is my friend Cassie, a recent new Cornell University graduate.
Not so recent American International College graduate, born in 1928, with 73 channels and stations that she provides over 12,000 cable television shows to.
and she has jokes also. She's also funny. So we have a bunch of jokes for you all today that we've been practicing. The first is Rattle. I'm gonna jump right in.
Marilyn babies her car. Her husband says it won't go anywhere without a rattle.
Jess. Chess.
Oh, describe the game of chess.
Describe the game of chess.
Yes, people sit at a table motionless for hours, but that's civil service.
Wait a minute, do we have any civil servants here? Oops, okay, not too, we can't laugh too hard at that one, right?
Boy or girl?
The two hardest working civil servants we know, yes.
A man in the maternity ward, the nurse shows up with a darling, baby in her arms. What'd you want, a boy or a girl? Well, I wanted a girl once. Sorry, this was a boy. Okay, that was my second choice.
Contact lenses.
Oh, the priest who was so religious that he would just contact lenses for stained glass.
And adders.
Manoah said to the snakes, go forth and multiply. And they said, we can't, we're adders.
If you like the show.
Yeah, if you like the show tonight, tell your friends. If you didn't, keep it our little secret.
Did you date Henny Youngman at some point in time?
Perfect guy.
My daughter, a man said, is looking for the perfect guy to marry. And I said, stop the search, honey. Your mother got the last one.
The manicurist?
Yes, what happened when the manicurist married the dentist? They fight tooth and nail.
Oh, that is a groaner.
That was a good one all day today. Light eater.
Yeah, Marilyn claims she's a light eater. As soon as it gets light, she eats.
And put on, put off.
Excuse me?
We always get this one. Put on, put off.
Oh, you know, diet's very interesting. While you put it off, it's putting on.
It's a good one. Coughing?
Doctor, you're coughing much easily this morning. Patient, I was up all night practicing.
Dartboard?
What was that?
Dartboard.
Oh, do you like your new doctor? Very much. It makes me nervous when he stores his hypodermic needles in a dartboard.
Sign in restaurant?
Sign in the restaurant. Don't make fun of our coffee. Someday you'll be old and weak too.
Sanka?
Why did they call you Sanka? Sanka. Why did they call you Sanka? No active ingredient in the bean. I think that goes back to 1960.
Yeah, I think there's a time element there.
Diploma.
One college is getting so fed up with college illiteracy that they're putting the diplomas on Facebook. All right. They're putting them on DVDs because I can't read them. All right.
Yeah, okay.
Big idea?
Yeah. Their first date, the girl says, has anybody ever told you how wonderful you are? He says, no. She says, well, where'd you get the big idea?
Track coach?
What was it?
Track coach.
Oh, track coach. Yeah, the man was bragging that when he was in college, he had the women running in circles, and his wife says, that's right, he was a track coach.
And cutting edge.
Excuse me?
Cutting edge.
Oh, What is your job? The young lady asked the young man on their first date. And he says, I'm on the cutting edge of technology. And his friend says, that's right, he mows the lawn at IBM.
No, that's
What about the fireman?
Oh, a young man came home from medical college and he said to his mom and dad, here it is. This was a diploma you wanted me to get. And from now, I'm going to do exactly what I told you I was going to do ever since I was 6 years old. I'm going out and be a fireman.
Last man on earth.
Excuse me?
The last man on earth.
I wouldn't marry you if you were the last man on earth. That's right, honey. You'd get caught in the rush. You'd get killed in the rush. You'd get killed in the rush, right?
You'd get killed in the rush. Rice?
Excuse me?
Rice?
Rice!
Rice.
Young man taking young lady to dinner. How do you want your rice? He's making out the menu. He said fried or boiled. And she said, thrown.
Yeah, thrown.
pulled right tooth?
Doc, you still haven't pulled the right tooth yet. I know, but I'm getting closer.
Sponge?
When the doctor operated on me, he left a sponge inside. Ooh, that must be uncomfortable. No, it just makes me thirsty.
ringing in the ears.
Again.
Ringing in the ears?
Oh, doc, I have a ringing in my ears. Doc, don't answer it.
Medical history?
The doctor says, let us begin by taking your medical history. Do you pay your bills?
Walk a mile.
Doc, you take one of these pills every day and you walk a mile a day, and at the end of the month you call me. At the end of the month the patient calls and says, hey Doc, what do I do now? I'm out of pills and 30 miles from home.
Old magazines.
And a woman says, I'm sure that my son is going to be a doctor. He already has 12 old magazines.
And the clean bill.
Did the doctor give you a clean bill of health? No, he won't do that until my check clears.
Very good. Queen of the one-liners.
Here's your camera.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Patrick, thank you so much for keeping...
This land was
Are we ready, everybody? Are we ready? Okay, I think the camera's there. I think it's that way. I think I'm looking at it. I don't know what color gloves these are, but they're either black or navy, aren't they? The blessings are counted through 2 p.m. Stand by. Take one. 5, 4, 3, 2. Go vegan! Take 2. Go vegan and know the peace. Take 3. 5, 4, 3, 2. Go vegan! 91 years old, no doctors and no medicine. Vegan! Take 3, cut 2. 5, 4, 3, 2. 91 years old, no doctors, no medicine, vegan. Take 3, cut 3, 5, 4, 3, 2. Go vegan. 91 years old, no doctors and no medicine. Count the blessings for 3 p.m. Stay dressed to see if we have it. Turn out the lights. 2. Thank you, lights. 3. Turn off the camera. 4. Go to the electronics bench. 5. Thank you, Gregory, for having these things all set up. 6. It was a smart thing to ask him to do. How much I appreciate it. 7. Get the spotlight. 8. Thank you, camera. 9. Thank you, tripod.
electricity. Lightning and electricity. You don't have to pay for lightning. You've heard the Wonder Diet? You eat anything you want, and then the next morning you wonder why your clothes don't fit. And you've heard of the Army Diet? Everything you eat goes to the front. This woman bought a new scale, and she brought him home. It was a scale, folks. There were men, you step on the scale, the man tells you how much you weigh. So she brought him home, she settled it, she stepped on it, and the man's voice said, "Please, one at a time." The man went on a diet and he didn't eat anything but bananas and coconuts. Did he lose weight? No, of course. You should see him climb trees. Alrighty. Man came home from work and he says, "Honey, honey, I'm gonna lose my job. The company found something that'll do the work of 5 men. And she said, "One woman?" Oh.
Go vegan!
brought him home. It was a scale, folks. There were men. You step on the scale, and the man tells you how much you weigh. So she brought him home. She stumbled up. She stepped on it, and the man's voice said, "Please, one at a time." The man went on a diet, and he didn't eat anything but bananas and coconuts. Did he lose weight? No, of course. You should see him climb trees. Man came home from work and he says, "Honey, honey, I'm going to lose my job. The company's found something that'll do the work of 5 men." And she said, "One woman?" "Oh." His wife says, "Did you have a good day at work here?" And he says, "No. They gave us aptitude tests and I flunked." She says, "That's terrible." He says, "Yeah, it's a good thing I own the company."
Go figure, everybody. 91 years old, no doctors and no medicine.
And he says, "God, why did you make Eve?" God says, "Well, I thought you were lonesome. Oh, God, why did you make her so beautiful? Well, so you would like her."
Well, you got two done.
Eat anything but bananas and coconuts? Did he lose weight? No, of course. You should see him climb trees. All righty. back at work, and he says, honey, honey, I'm gonna lose my job. The company found something that'll do the work of 5 minutes. And she said, one woman? Oh. His wife says, did you have a good day at work here? And he says, no. They gave us aptitude tests, and I flunked. She says, that's terrible. He says, yeah, it's a good thing I own the company.
And this is, and what's this?
The 65 TV stations Boston to San Diego.
Yeah, sure.
think I could do that dancing, do you?
Hey, give it a shot.
You said you twinges and the hinges. And you know you're getting old, folks.
Go be in. Enjoy the peace. Be harmless. Be harmless.
When you're out in the evening and you're having a good time and you're faced with two temptations, you'll take them while I'm getting home at 9:30. Well, how good is your memory, folks? How do you feel about your memory? How good is it? Because I'm wondering if I can get by with telling you jokes I've told you for 4 years. You're a little early here for church, folks. It's not going to start until tomorrow morning. All righty. Why did the housewife put popcorn into the pancake bag? So the pancakes would turn over by themselves. And the boss says that he believes in reincarnation. Did you ever notice at 5 p.m. everybody comes back to life? A man called the hospital and he said, I'm inquiring as to the condition of James Parsons.
Go vegan. Be blameless.
Well, Mr. Parsons,
be harmless.
Have a good sleep.
Enjoy the peace.
Comfortably today. But we think tomorrow we'll be discharged. Who's calling? The man said, James Parsons, the doctor didn't tell me anything. But he called a smart duck, folks. When he called a smart duck, a wise quacker. And what is the difference between lightning and electricity? Lightning and electricity. You don't have to pay for lightning. You've heard of the Wonder Diet? You eat anything you want, and then the next morning you wonder why your clothes don't fit. And you've heard of the Army Diet? Everything you eat goes to the front. Brought him home. It was a scale, folks, where a man, you step on the scale, the man tells you how much you weigh. So she brought him home, she stepped on it, and the man's voice said, please, one at a time. A man went on a diet, and he didn't eat anything but bananas and coconuts. Did he lose weight? No, of course. You should see him climb trees. Man came home from work and he says, honey, I'm going to lose my job. The company's found something that'll do the work of 5 minutes. And she said, one woman? Oh! His wife says, do you have a good day at work here? And he says, no. They gave us aptitude tests, and I flunked. She says, that's terrible. He says, yeah, it's a good thing I own the company. The Swedish construction crew, folks, got a job refurbishing an apartment way up on the fourth floor. And in the late afternoon, the foreman came by, close up, and he said, hey, you guys finished? They said, no, we're siege.
Go vegan, enjoy the peace, be blameless, be harmless. No, this is number four.
God, why did you make Eve? God says, well, I thought you were lonesome. Well, God, why did you make her so beautiful? Well, so you would like her. Well, God, why did you make her so dumb? So she would like you.
Go vegan for the planet. For the animals, and for you.
$1 million to you? God said, $10. And the man said, well, God, how much is $1 million years to you? And God said, 1 second. And the man says, God, can I have $10? And God said, just a second.
Go vegan. 91 years old. No doctors and no medicine.
came along and he said, "You look dejected. What's the matter?" The Adam says, this is an Adam, A-D-O-M. The Adam says, "I'm not an Adam any longer. I'm an ion. I lost an electron." The man says, "Are you sure?" And he says, "I'm positive."
Go vegan, everybody. Enjoy the peace.
Go to school together every morning, and they come home in the afternoon together. And everybody thought that was endearing. It went on for years. Then one day it all stopped. The dog graduated. Now, the owner of the shop said to his employee, "I saw you are a regular customer. It's a strict policy of the shop, the customer is always right. Now, I never want to see you argue with the customer again. You understand that?" And the little employee said, "Yes, sir." And the owner said, "Well, what were you arguing about?" And the employee said, "He said you were an idiot."
You were an idiot.
Go vegan!
Oh God, why did you make her so beautiful? so you would like her. Well, God, why did you make her so dumb? So she would like you. A man is talking to God, and he says, God, how much is $1 million to you? God said, $10. And the man said, well, God, how much is $1 million to you? And God said, 1 second. And the man says, God, can I have $10? And God said, just a second. And Adam was sitting on a park bench, and he looked dejected. And a man came along and he said, you look dejected. What's the matter? And the Adam says, this is an Adam, A-D-O-M. The Adam says, I'm not an Adam any longer. I'm an ion. I lost an electron. And the man says, are you sure? And he says, I'm positive. Go to school together every morning, and they come home in the afternoon together. And everybody thought that was endearing. It went on for years. Then one day it all stopped. The dog graduated. Now,
go vegan, everybody.
I saw you arguing with a customer. It's a strict policy of the shop that the customer is always right. Now, I never want to see you argue with the customer again. Do you understand that? And the little employee said, yes, sir. And the owner said, well, what were you arguing about? And the employee said, he said you were an idiot.
Go vegan!
He's not much of a fighter, is he? and the owner of a truck stop said, he's not much of a driver either, he just drove over three motorcycles.
Go vegan!
A little boy had a little red leg. To go all the way back, so you play it. Took it out on the street just as he went by the church. Just as he went by the church, all the wheels fell off. And he says, well, I'll be darned. And the next day, he takes his little red wagon down the street, gets to the church, and all the wheels fall off. He says, I'll be. A little boy had a little red blanket, and he had took it out on the street just as he went by the church. Just as he went by the church, all the wheels. And three men on three motorcycles parked them outside, came in, and one of the motorcycles turned over the truck driver's cup of coffee, and another one turned over his glass of water, and a third one turned over his plate of dinner. So the truck driver got up, he paid his bill, and he went out. And one motorcycle said to the other, he's not much of a fighter, is he? And the owner of the truck stop said, he's not much of a driver either, he just drove over three motorcycles. A little boy had a little red blanket, and he had took it out on the street just as he went by the church. Just as he went by the church, all the wheels fell off. And he says, well, I'll be darned. The next day, he takes his little red wagon down the street, gets to the church, and all the wheels fall off. He says, I'll be darned. Third day, he takes out his little red wagon, gets to the church, all the wheels fall off, and he says, I'll be darned. And the priest came out, and he says, that is not a good thing for you to say, I'll be darned. You shouldn't say, I'll be darned. You should say, I thank you, God, I praise you, God, I love you, God. So the next day, when the little boy took his wagon by the church, all the wheels fell off. He said, I love you, God, I praise you, God, I thank you, God. And all the wheels went back on, and the priest said, I'll be darned.
Go vegan!
In church. a Bible sonic contest. The man who sold the most Bibles started, he started severely poor. So the parishioner said, well, what do you say to the people who sell the most Bibles? He said, go vegan. 91 years old, no doctors and no medicine. Well, let's go talk to each other and see what next we want to do. What next should we do? Not bad.
Hi.
Good. It sounds to me like it's recording.
REC.
Do you see REC?
Yep.
Okay, then we're fine.
Okay. Now.
Are we both in the picture?
Yes.
We are both there.
We
okay.
will be. Looks like we have remains from last night's dinner on here. All right, take it away.
5, 4, 3, 2. Welcome to A Chat with Glendora, and I'm so glad, Mr. Kurt Vincent, that you had time to come and tell us about your recent tour and the events that have happened in our little Nassau.
Little Nassau, yes. We went to see the spot where the most Nassau citizens are gathered in one place. The cemetery. So, as regular viewers may know that this is 2019, the 200th anniversary of the incorporation of the village of Nassau, all the way back in 1819. The town had already been established, but for whatever reason, the folks in the village, which was always the most populous section of the town, and still is, decided that they wanted to form their own municipality, and they did. And ever since then, we have had a village. There's been a few attempts to dissolve the village, a few attempts to modify the village, but pretty much it has stayed about as it was originally formed in 1819, in March of 1819. So as village historian, I'm very interested in the history of our community and have done a number of programs and worked with other volunteers in coming up with ideas and displays and activities to get young folks, older folks, people interested in history, people not interested in history, a little bit of an idea of what makes Nassau a little unique, maybe. So earlier in the month, we had a beautiful sunny Saturday morning, and I led an intrepid group of about 25 interested individuals on a tour of the officially named Nassau Skodak Cemetery, which is located in the village of Nassau, Rensselaer County, on U.S. Route 203. So if any of you would like to visit the cemetery, it's on Route 203 or Chatham Street, as we call it locally, but you can't miss it. If you go on Route 203 south of the village, the cemetery will be on your right hand. So the cemetery, first of all, let me just give a disclaimer or two. I'm in no way connected with the cemetery. I'm not on the cemetery board. When I asked them for permission to do this, they granted me permission and they said that would be great because we don't know anything about the history of our cemetery. So how about that?
Will someday will you be connected with the cemetery?
I don't think so. I've got enough things in my pile to take care of. But the cemetery was incorporated in the year 1848, which means that the village had already been here. And at that time, the land that is now the cemetery that was purchased for that purpose was farmland. And in the village of Nassau, two of the major activities, farming activities, which are long, long, long gone, are raising horses for export and raising buckwheat for both consumption and for the other uses for the buckwheat plant. The horses were shipped to the Caribbean, to the West Indies, where there was a demand for horsepower. Of course, this is long before the internal combustion engine. And Nassau was a little bit noted for that. And then the buckwheat is an interesting story because we've all heard of buckwheat pancakes and maybe buckwheat groats and buckwheat flour. But they also used other parts of the plant for paper making, for example. The hull of the buckwheat can be used in the production of paper. And there were paper mills in the town. And they also use the straw or the grass portion of it as feed for animals and also for stuffing mattresses. So if you ever got a lumpy mattress, maybe it's stuffed with buckwheat. We don't know. So back to the cemetery. Currently there are over 3,000 interments in the Nassau Skodak portion, and I say that because there are actually two portions. In 1873, St. Mary's Roman Catholic Church purchased adjacent property, and there are about 1,000 interments there, so a total of 4,000. And as time has marched on, the St. Mary portion of the cemetery is now completely surrounded by the Nassau Skodak portion.
There's only 1,100 in the village.
See, that's why we have more people in the cemetery than we do in the village. It is one of 400 cemeteries in Rensselaer County. That's hard to believe, isn't it?
Yeah.
There are 400 cemeteries. And do you know how many there are in the town of Nassau? How many cemeteries?
No.
Take a guess.
Four.
45.
No.
There are 45 cemeteries. The vast majority of them are not active.
They are
small family plots because Nassau is basically a rural community, and if someone was born on the farm and died on the farm, there was probably a family burying ground nearby. So there's 45 cemeteries in the town of Nassau and 29 in the town of Skodak. So this is an example where Nassau people and Skodak people got together and formed something together. Documented 19 Revolutionary War soldier graves. In 1907, plots were $1 each.
No.
$1. I don't know what they are currently. I didn't want to be rude and ask. And in 1967, when the state was pondering a bypass highway that would eliminate the section of Route 20 that goes right through the center of the village, one of the three proposals would have been through the cemetery. None of those proposals were finalized because also in the plans was a totally different connection between Albany and the Berkshire Spur, or I-90 as we call it, and that was in fact built. And it bypassed, the Nassau bypass totally bypassed Nassau. And the reason for that is the village of Nassau lies in the bottom of a valley with hills on either side, with Route 20, the main Boston to Buffalo Road. And there were a tremendous amount of accidents in the post-war years. It was and still is a pretty heavily traveled commercial road.
Goes all the way to Oregon.
Goes all the way across the country. It's the longest federal highway in the United States.
Oh, it is?
I just read that little fact. So there were a lot of accidents, very devastating accidents. So because that was a concern, they were thinking about trying to reroute the traffic so they would not have to face those two large hills, but it never happened. So back to the cemetery. As in many local cemeteries, we see the same names over and over and over again. Some of the names date back to the early 1700s and are listed on a Van Rensselaer tenant map. Now, the Van Rensselaers were the patroon, the Dutch appointed commercial business leaders of this area. And it was a very, very large area, 25 miles on each side of the Hudson River for the Van Rensselaer allotment. And we see those names as Van Valkenburg, Mikkel, Shaver, Payne, Whitbeck on the Skodak
Van
side.
Van Alstine?
Nope. Garrison, Primer, Bliss, Hogenboom on the Nassau side. So those were all listed in the early 1700s. Once the English took over from the Dutch, they commissioned a survey of the tenants. And this part of the county was very sparsely populated, very, very sparsely populated. But those are some of the names. Of the folks that are buried in the cemetery, if you know street names and road names in Nassau and Skodak, these will be very common, very familiar. Lowry, Payne, Kingman, Lord, McClellan, Meade, Bliss, Maury, Rosecrans, Lape, Poinier, Waterbury, Lord, and Irish. Those are all families that have roads named after them, probably because they were farmers and originally the road went to their place, and it was always known as the road to the Irish farm or Lord's Hill or whatever, and those names have stayed. Now, as we get into specific names, Barringer, B-A-R-R-I-N-G-E-R, very large family in the Skodak-Nassau area. There are farmers, landowners. And like many of the settlers in this area, in the 1700s, they came from Europe to Dutchess County. Now, in this case, Barringer, as you might guess, is a German name. The first son left for Greenbush, as it was called, in the 1750s, and the grandchildren came to Skodak and Nassau. So the first generation had 8 children. The second generation, 45 children. And the 33rd generation, and this is just 3 generations away from the original inhabitants, guess how many descendants there were for 3 generations?
75.
115.
Wow.
Big families, lots of people, and in the cemetery there are 47 Barringers.
Oh, really?
Laid to eternal rest. The last burial was in 1952.
Really?
Really. McClellan is also a very, very common name. There was a Dr. McClellan, an early physician,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Came to Nassau in 1812, remained until his death in 1855, had sons who were attorneys, lived in Skodak, and had the business in Nassau. And their great-grandson, George, was a U.S. congressman just before World War I, McClellan.
Yeah.
Herrick is another very common name. Lewis Herrick was born in Dutchess County, 1773, died in Nassau in 1860. His son, Rufus, went to East Greenbush. His son, Castle, C-A-S-T-L-E, was a very prominent citizen of Nassau, born in 1811, married Jane Hermance, another name you'll hear. He was a trustee of Nassau Academy, parents of 6 children. And a son, Lewis, was the inventor of Herrick's liver pills. Now, that is very well documented that Herrick liver pills came from Nassau, New York, but I've never been able to find anything else other than they came here and Herrick was the inventor, and don't know what they did. I don't know how well they worked, but that's a little claim to fame. And the Herricks had 27 descendants buried in Nassau. Frickinger, another family, a relatively new family, they were the ones that started the piano building concerns in both Nassau and in Castleton, Frickinger. And the Frickingers were a childless married couple who lived in New York City in Astoria, Queens. If you know your musical instrument history, you know there was another famous family that lived in Astoria, Queens, the Steinways. And the Frickingers decided to come to upstate New York for vacation. They came to Albany, said, we want to see a little bit of the countryside, rented a wagon and a horse, and fate took them over what now is Route 20 into Skodak, and they stopped to admire a beautiful flower garden, and as they were admiring the flowers, a man came out of the house, they got into conversation, and the man said, oh, by the way, this house is for sale. And they decided on the spot to buy the house, to relocate from New York City. And he was in the business of making piano actions. And a piano action is not the entire piano, but the system of levers and hammers that when you push the key on a piano keyboard through the mechanism, a felt hammer strikes the string. Each string is tuned to a different pitch, and as you hit all of the different keys, you get all the pitches that are on a piano. So he was an early industrialist, very successful, and he decided to relocate to Skodak, what now we call Bunker Hill, and that's where the first piano factory was. And he met some other people along the way, and we'll talk about them in a minute. Van Valkenburgh's, one of the oldest Nassau Skodak families, traced their lineage to the Dutch colony. Peter, born in 1782, lived on the post road in Skodak, which we would call now Route 9, came to Nassau in 1814. Early property owner and businessman, ran a hotel in Nassau and then farmed. His son, Smith Van Valkenburgh, had a mercantile store, a general store. He owned 110 acres of land. And the land that he owned is now where our post office, Little League Field, Senior Citizens Apartments, and Village Commons Park was. So all of that property was owned by Smith Van Valkenburgh. His son was educated at the Nassau Academy, and the Nassau Academy was a boys' school, a private boys' school, boarding school, that had a very, very good reputation. And there are records where parents who had raised their children in the city of Albany and sent them to Albany Academy to a certain age, then decided they would get a better education in Nassau. I don't think that's still the case, but they came to Nassau. John was, age of 21, was appointed as a town clerk, justice of the peace for 11 years, elected supervisor. In 1869, married Sarah Mead, who had four daughters. One, Maria, was the wife of Delmer Lynn, spelled like Delmar, but I believe the pronunciation was Delmer. And the Lynn brothers were pharmacy owners in Nassau. We've had a Nassau pharmacy for almost 150 years, and it's only been four owners. They had a son named John Albert. And when he was 23 years old, he was drafted into the military for World War I. And at that time, he was a student of electrical engineering at RPI. He was sent to North Tarrytown, New York for training, and was initially rated as a gunner's mate, third class. However, he had a background and a hobby in wireless radio that was noted, and later he was sent to Harvard and Cambridge to go to radio school, where he learned Morse code, among other things. And he had the ability to do 22 words a minute on Morse code. And that was considered very, very good. He was assigned to the fleet and was transferred to a escort for convoys going across the North Atlantic to support the U.S. war effort in World War I. In February 1918, he had already spent 16 months aboard the USS Costco, probably named after Costco Bay, and as a supply ship made seven crossings of the Atlantic and a stint on a minesweeping vessel. In the summer of 1919, he was still serving, but after hostilities ended, he had made several attempts to leave the Navy on account of a serious illness with his father. Each time his commander replied that he was too valuable a man to be spared. Late in October, as radio operator, he received the message saying that the father's illness would soon prove fatal, and only then was he permitted to come home on leave. Unfortunately, the weather took a hand in it, and it was a very, very rough sea, and it took him longer than usual to cross the Atlantic. Oh. By the time he returned to Nassau and actually came home, his father had died several days sad. Earlier. Oh. Mr. Lynn was formally discharged in May 1920. He was in the service for 3 years, and he was the first man in the town of Nassau to enlist and the last to be discharged. After the war, he remained in Nassau and was active in veterans organizations. He died in 1949 at the age of 54 and is buried in Nassau Cemetery. Another individual who had quite an interesting military career, a gentleman named Samuel Lennon, Samuel J. Lennon, born in Skodak, the son of James and Mary, who were natives of Wicklow, Ireland. Son was educated in common schools, which was considered public schools. At the age of 10, he was sent as an apprentice to the confectionery and pastry business.
Wait!
And after 5 years of that, he progressed to a journeyman in the confectionery and pastry business. At the age of 18, he enlisted in Company C, 12th U.S. Infantry, serving 3 years in the Army. During the Civil War in 1861, he enlisted as a drummer boy. In 1862, he was made a private. In 1863, a corporal in the Color Guard. And about a week before the end of his enlistment, he was taken prisoner and held in a Confederate prison for 6 months. Now, there's quite a story about the conditions of Confederate prison camps as being absolutely horrendous. Mr. Lennon had fought in the battles of Yorktown, Second Battle of Bull Run, South Mountain, Antietam, Fredericksburg, Chancellorsburg, Gettysburg, the Wilderness, Spotsylvania, Bethesda Church, Cold Harbor, and others. And each of these are noted on his headstone. At the close of the war, Mr. Lennon was sick for 2 years due to his internment, but returned to the confectionery business in Nassau. His business rapidly increased, and his output of sweets annually exceeded 1/2 ton, 1,000 pounds of candy a year. Mr. Lennon was a correspondent for local newspapers and lived a long life. In the 1900s, he would be invited every year to the Nassau School to speak to the students about his Civil War experiences.
Not about candy?
Not about candy.
How do you spell Lennon?
L-E-N-N-O-N, no relation to the Soviet Lenin. Another interesting stone in the cemetery, which we probably wouldn't pay any attention to unless you read the story, was Louis Potter. He was an American artist known for sculpture, studied in Paris, also worked in, printmaking and sketching. The inscription reads, "Who wrought in bronze and marble many works of exceeding beauty and power? He ever felt a nearness to the infinite life and the abiding faith in an eternal existence. In his short passage on this earth, he left a rich inheritance to his fellow man." Now, that would make you say, I wonder what happened. And every good detective, I mean historian, wants to know what happened. So, Mr. Potter, whose middle name was McClellan, which should give you a hint as to why he's buried in Nassau, was very, very interested in native peoples. And when he was in Paris, he went to Morocco to study the Arabs. When he came back to America, he went out west to study the Native Americans, and then went to Alaska to study the Native Americans in Alaska, and all the time sketching, drawing, making busts of these, what he found to be extremely fascinating faces. Mr. Potter, unfortunately, died an early death. It was suspicious. It was in Seattle, and a post-mortem determined that after treatment by a Chinese doctor, he showed the indications of phosphorus poisoning. Leng Hang Chow, the doctor who treated Potter, is still missing, as is the sculptor's woman companion. And this is 1912 from the newspaper of the day. So he died a mysterious death. He was treated by a Chinese, which was, at that time was considered very, very suspicious. And the woman he was with disappeared. So one can only guess at what happened. Moving along to some of the interments in Nassau Cemetery, Major Bush, 1755 to 1845, fought the Battle of Lexington, Bunker Hill, and Saratoga. Born in Sheffield, Mass. In 1790 census indicated he had 2 slaves and 8 children. There are 16 family members here. Now, slavery was not outlawed in New York State until the 1800s. And the 1790 census, the first U.S. federal census, does indicate who was a slaveholder, and there were about 6 slaves in the town of Nassau. Husted, another common name, Father Titus settled about 2 miles east of the village. His son Jesse, born in 1833, was a pioneer in card printing. Nassau was known as a place where business cards or calling cards were printed, and at the time, a quote about Mr. Husted was, "given employment to many persons, aiding largely in making the village prosperous." There were 6 printing businesses in the village of Nassau at that time, and his son C.E. Husted ran the general store on Church Street, one of the many owners of the general store. Van Allen, another common name, he was a iron worker, and he had a foundry on Church Street, made plows, cultivators, and straw cutters, going back to that buckwheat straw, and the business was called the Eagle Foundry. When the piano factory needed iron fittings for the piano actions. The Van Allen Foundry made those actions, and eventually the foundry was purchased by the piano action company. And the story is that because they were located not far from the former Dutch Reformed Church, that an ember from the foundry fire was carried away on the breeze and lodged in the belfry of the wooden church, and the church basically burned to the ground in 1899. Grubb, G-R-U-B-B, and I have it on good faith that that is how it's pronounced and not Grubb, was another family, 1838-1905, who was involved with a piano action, and he went to work for Mr. Frickinger, and Mr. Frickinger was very fond of him, so he made him a full partner. Mr. Grubb had a daughter who married another piano action worker who decided, I'm going to start my own piano action works in Castleton. And there was a Cheney piano action factory in Castleton, not as successful as ours here in Nassau, of course, but nonetheless, it spun off. For a while, the piano action company was known by Grubb and Cozy Garden, which was the next family that bought an interest into it, and we'll talk about that in a minute. And no story about Nassau can go without the Hoag, H-O-A-G family, considered to be the founders of the area, early developers, land speculators, Jonathan Hoag. His grandson, had five children. Of that, Thomas and Hannah, his wife, had a house built for them by Elder Hoag, and that house still stands, as do many of the properties in the village of Nassau, and is on the National Register of Historic Places.
Where is it?
It is on Church Street, the house next to the former Red Brick Hotel, on your right-hand side.
Oh.
Below the library.
And Mr. Hoag's factory, one of them, he had one of them.
He had mills, yes, he started a lumber mill. Son Thomas was a member of the New York State Assembly in 1840.
And was Mr. Hoag?
Which one?
The original, was he in the, he was in the Assembly, wasn't he?
No, he passed away, I believe, before New York was a state. And there are 35 Hoags buried in the Nassau Cemetery. Now, one of the stories about how the Nassau Skodak Cemetery came about is there was a Hoag family cemetery not far from this location on Elm Street, and what happened was initially the parcels that were sold by the existing landowners were quite large. They were sold as farmsteads. So they were not just enough for a house and a barn. They had fields and they had ponds and they had everything that goes with a fully functioning farm. And as time moved on and more commercialization, that property in the center of the crossroads was deemed to be valuable, and they started splitting properties into smaller and smaller and smaller parcels. The story is that the location of the Hoag family cemetery was in one of those locations that had more of a commercial value as new development than keeping a cemetery there. So supposedly, and there are not many records that prove one way or another, all of the graves that were in the Hoag family cemetery were relocated to the, at that time, new Nassau Skodak Cemetery.
Was it near my house?
Well, it is maybe 20 houses that-a-way, 20 houses down the street. So maybe, dug in your back lawn, who knows what you'll find out there.
Did you say Elm Street? There was a
Yes, Elm Street.
And whereabouts on Elm Street?
Towards the corner of Albany Avenue, back in there. Another name in Nassau was Griffith. Joshua G. was born in 1767. Died in 1841, son of Welsh immigrants, fought in the War of 1812, ending as a rank of major. He married Ruth Payne. You may remember the name Payne from Payne Road. The Griffiths were elders in the Presbyterian Church.
P-A-Y-N-E?
P-A-Y-N-E. And during the Civil War, helped with the Underground Railroad liberating slaves from the South. prominent citizens, owned several properties, married twice, and had 16 children. How about that? One of the daughters married a Major General Wool, and Major General Wool lived on Church Street next to the general store, and at the time of the Civil War, he was the oldest general at the start of the Civil War. He had fought in the Mexican War and the War of 1812 and lived in Nassau for a brief period, who was also related to Chester Griswold, that has a street named after him in Nassau, and the Griswolds were very involved with the cast iron production business in Troy. Another name that we see is Lord, east of the village, Lord's Hill Road. In 1899, Neville Lord was a victim of murder, and a man by the name of Archie Mull was suspected in the murder. He was accused of using an axe to murder farmer Neville Lord for a debt of $25. He was quickly captured. There were many sightings of Mr. Mull that day, both going and coming back from the Lord farm, and a trial was scheduled in December. Now, this was September, October, November, December, so about 3 months down. The first trial was scheduled in Troy. In January 1900, the jury rendered its verdict, 11 guilty, but one holdout refused to make it unanimous, so it was declared a mistrial. A second trial soon began. The district attorney pleading with the jury, "Don't let it be said, I beseech you, that 12 honest men cannot be found within the borders of Rensselaer County." Now, at the time, in order to be a juror, A, you had to be male, and B, you had to be a property owner. So they had a very hard time finding jurors that were property owners, even though they claimed to be, and did not have a connection with either of the lawyers representing Mr. Mull or Mr. Lord. So they went through many, many, many prospective jurors till they finally got 12. That second jury found Mr. Mull guilty within several hours, and the judge sentenced him to death by electrocution, scheduled for the week of March 6th. He was jailed awaiting electrocution. Mull's attorneys appealed the verdict, charged that a jury member had been bribed, and questioned the legality of certain evidence that was presented. Now remember, the district attorney pleaded for a swift trial. On March 6th, the date of the supposed execution came and went while the bribery claim was investigated. The investigation proved that a juror from Sand Lake was indeed bribed by members of the Rensselaer County Bar Association. He was offered $300 to vote for not guilty, forcing an acquittal. 2 years after the murder, the State Court of Appeals granted Mull a new trial. That trial was scheduled for January of 1902. At the time, a murder trial was certain death. Mull then changed his plea to manslaughter, guilty to murder in the second degree, so that he would have a life sentence and not be executed. He was then sentenced to life in prison. But the story does not end here. In 1919, about 17 years later, at the time, a gentleman by the name of Al Smith was governor of New York State, who issued a clemency for Mr. Mull. Meanwhile, the state legislature was changing term limits for crimes, including second degree murder. So whether he had been granted clemency by Governor Smith, or because he had spent the allotted time in prison, he was due to be released. And when he walked out of Great Meadow Prison in Comstock, he was welcomed by his longtime girlfriend, Stella Howe, who stayed in contact with him all those years from 1899. She had waited 20 years for her boyfriend. He was now about 40 and had served in Dannemora, Sing Sing, and Comstock to return to her arms. How's that for a love story? But it's not over. Immediately, the two went to the nearest town clerk's office to get a marriage license and were married by a local minister. Two prison officials, impressed by Mull's exemplary behavior while behind bars, witnessed the marriage. They honeymooned here in Nassau, where the horrible story, but with a happy ending, began. Archie and Stella moved to Massachusetts, where he worked in a shoe factory, and died of natural causes in 1948.
In Massachusetts?
In Massachusetts.
They never came back to Nassau?
They never came back.
Oh, they never did.
Well, I think they probably would have had a cold shoulder had they come back. Because essentially they did not prove who murdered Neville Lord.
Right, and there's no well-founded suspicions as to who did?
Well, I think the well-founded suspicions was that he did it. I think it was very well-founded. Some of the testimony was provided by, at that time, underage boys. And because they were underage, it was not considered admissible.
But including, he thought he was there, right?
He was there and attacked at the same time. So,
and the boy testified that it was Mr.
Yes,
Mull?
Yes. Yep. Let's see, where are we here? Boughton's. There's two spellings for Boughton, B-O-U-G-H-T-O-N and B-O-U-T-O-N. Came to Nassau from Danbury, Connecticut via Dutchess County. Born in 1768, died in Nassau in 1840. One of the founders of the Presbyterian Church, had two wives, 8 children by his first, 5 by his second, and there are 37 Boughtons in Nassau Cemetery.
We don't have a Presbyterian church now,
do we? That is a very good question. Originally there was what was called a Union Church, where the Dutch Reform, the Presbyterians, and the Lutherans all worshipped in the same building at various times and various days. Well, that caused a dispute over who had the right to do when, to do what when, and it caused the ending of the Union Church. Reformed Church built their own building. The Lutherans went away, maybe the East Godak, I'm not sure. And the Presbyterians built their own church. The Presbyterians, however, folded their church in the late 1800s, where the building became a private home, and as it is today, a private home, right here on Elm Street.
It was moved from Route 20 over
Elm
Street?
That's right.
How could they do that?
They knew how to do things like that then. It was common occurrence. They would do it in the winter when the ground was frozen. They had oxen. They built the pyramids. They could certainly move a big old barn-like building. Very, very common. Alrighty, let's see. We're talking about Reuben Rogers, a soldier of the American Revolution, his headstone says. Born in Huntington, Long Island, lived in Amenia, Dutchess County. Shortly moved to Nassau, married 3 times. Married a merchant, a Lovell, and a Hollister, 8 children. He was a soldier in the Revolution and one time commander of the Bunker Hill Barefoots. Now, this is a story that has been told since the 1800s, been documented since the 1800s, but in researching it, I found the same story told for other people as well. So I will give the proviso that this may or may not be true. When he was commander of the Bunker Hill Barefoots, it is said that the soldiers drilled or learned to march with hay tied to one foot and straw to the other because they did not understand left, right, left, right. But the commander could yell, "Hay foot, straw foot, hay foot, straw foot," and they learned to march. Now, as I say, that story is told about other military. That is a stretch, yes. Wyatt D. Jacques, a Frenchman born 1763, Groton, Connecticut, lived in Rhinebeck. His wife was Jemima Pauling. Now, I know you're not a native of these parts, but we have a famous street in the city of Troy named Pauling, and Pauling was the first mayor of the city of Troy. And the daughter of Major John Pauling, Revolutionary and Colonial War leader, and son Edward was the founder of the Nassau, Scodac, and Chatham Mutual Insurance Association. His son, Irving, was killed at Gettysburg when he was 20 years old. We have Hitchcocks in the cemetery. Dr. Samuel Hitchcock, another early doctor, born in Sharon, Connecticut, died in Scodac, 1806.
Hitchcock chairs?
Maybe. His wife, Jemima Barlow Hitchcock, on her gravestone says, when she and 10 other family members, says she and 10 other family members were poisoned by arsenic mixed in the butter by a servant girl.
Oh no.
Can you believe that? Skullduggery in Nassau. Yes, yes.
Here in Nassau?
Here in Nassau. Now, another one of the business card manufacturers was George Reed. He had four presses running, supposedly produced 4 million cards annually, and at the time, a trade publication said, quote, business from all states and territories, the Canadas, France, England, Russia, Sweden, China, and Japan. How about that? Another large family in Nassau were the Merchant family, farmers and then lawyers, born in Woodbury, Connecticut, soldier in the Revolutionary War, fought at the Battle of Saratoga. In 1772, his account book shows that he was also a tailor. His son Reuben, born in Dutchess County, was a lawyer, and they were very well known. Graduated from Union College after preparatory courses at Nassau Academy, secretary and treasurer of the Nassau and Scodac Cemetery Association. His wife Clara is one of the founders and devoted supporters of the Nassau Free Library.
Who?
Clara. Who was the granddaughter of William Doughty, D-O-T-Y, an ancestor of Edward Doughty, who arrived on the Mayflower.
No.
It is true. Her maternal grandfather was Stephen Van Rensselaer. So to say they were connected is an understatement.
Stephen, that's our Stephenville, right?
That's our Stephenville, the one and only. Hermance, I think we mentioned that name, early settlers of Nassau, came to America from Holland in 1660. Garrett Hermance, born in Dutchess County, died in Nassau, leased a farm from the Van Rensselaer's southwest corner of Phillipstown. Phillipstown was one of the names of Nassau Village, Philip being another of the Van Rensselaer's. Daughter Mary Castle Herrick, we talked about that. Son Reverend Henry Hermance married Nancy Herrick. Another member of the family was Philip Hermance, again born in Dutchess County. William P. Hermance married Rachel Harder, who also leased from the Van Rensselaer's a sawmill. He was captain in the state militia, one of the signers of the village charter in 1819, as well as a founder of Albany Nassau Academy.
Where did he live?
He lived on the corner of Malden Street and Griswold. The house is still standing.
It is?
It is. Across the street, he had a carriage factory that employed 40 people.
Wow.
One of the most prominent early industries. 48 family members are buried in Nassau. And a collection of his tools is in the local history collection of the Nassau Free Library, given by one of his daughters. So we still have woodworking tools from the carriage factory.
It's still there?
It is still there. The building is no longer there, but the tools remain. A Nassau Cemetery also has two designated plots, one from the former Presbyterian Church and one from the Reformed Church. So if any Presbyterians or adherent Reformed people die, they can be buried in the church plot. And then we have the Smiths. Many Smiths around, but we had the brothers Nicholas Tunis, Henry Tunis, and Michael Tunis Smith. They came to Nassau from Linlithgow, Southern Columbia County.
What's the middle name?
Tunis, T-U-N-I-S. Their father, Tuna Smith, was a Revolutionary War veteran and lived at what is called Middlebrook Farms on Route 203. However, the Smiths were born as Schmidt, descendants of Palatine Germans. Henry had 6 children, Nicholas 5. Son Michael is called Honest Michael, the first Nassau slave owner to free his slaves in 1810, 11 years before slavery was abolished in Nassau. And now this is only a highlight of the older sections of Nassau Cemetery. There's a lot more stories, a lot more
family there are
names. Absolutely. Every grave is a story.
Yeah.
Sometimes I feel like I know them better than I know people who are alive. So Glendora,
you like them better too.
You've been, they don't talk back. You've been on a tour of the Nassau Library without leaving your living room.
Yeah.
How about that? So thank you for inviting me. Hopefully we'll have some other bicentennial news to share with you and your viewers.
Well, I think it's grand that you had 25 people.
And have run into people who said, I didn't know that was going to happen. I wish I knew. I would have come. So we'll probably do it again. This is the first time I've ever done a cemetery tour. So I wasn't quite sure what angles to cover, but it was well received.
Well, I'm pretty impressed that you covered them all.
Not all. So we're going to say goodbye from Glendora. Goodbye from Kurt. Do you have a sign-off tagline?
Yes. The only thing that really matters, after all is said and done, is how did you treat of us?
Here, here.